Macmillan Audio presents Just Kids from the Bronx, Telling It the Way It Was, An Oral History by Arlene Alda, read for you by Alan Alda and others.
All author proceeds from Just Kids from the Bronx will be given to organizations that benefit children now living in the Bronx.
To the young writers and scientists and artists and musicians and actors and educators and doctors and lawyers and nurses and sports figures and business people and politicians who are the future of the Bronx. And to the memory of my parents who had the good sense to move to the Bronx in the first place. Stories have to be told or they die, and when they die, we can't remember who we are or why we're here. Sue Monk Kidd, The Secret Life of Bees. Foreword. A few summers ago, my husband Alan and I were at a friend's house on Long Island having pre-dinner snacks and drinks when I heard the words, "In the Bronx," said by Millard Mickey Drexler, who I met for the first time minutes before. "Are you from the Bronx?" I asked. "I'm from the Northeast, Barnes and Arno Avenues," Mickey answered. "You're kidding, which building?" "The Mayflower," he said. "That's unbelievable. That's my building." We tried to figure out why we hadn't met when we were kids. The Mayflower has 96 apartments, that's a lot of people, but the age difference, I'm 11 years older, was probably the biggest factor. When I was in high school, Mickey was a toddler. That age gap disappeared completely when we talked nonstop like long-lost friends at dinner time, deciding that it would be fun to go back to the Mayflower together. So a few months later, we went. New buddies revisiting our old building. Alan, Mickey's cousin, and a few of Mickey's longtime friends from the neighborhood came with us. It had been well over 50 years since either Mickey or I had lived in the Mayflower, and 30 years since I had last visited. Would Mickey be able to see his old apartment? No. No one answered the doorbell when he rang. What did the Mayflower look like now, seen with our grown-up sensibilities? On the outside, the same as ever, a six-story tan and brown brick building taking up half a city block. Mickey, chairman and CEO of J. Crew, led the way inside, the rest of us following. The lobby looked stark, a big contrast to my upscale Manhattan apartment building with its lobby furniture, area rugs, and walls hung with art. The simple Mayflower interior served as a pointed reminder of the unexpected turns my life had taken. Still, I felt totally at home seeing the familiar, worn terrazzo stairways and floor of the old building, which triggered vivid childhood memories. Energetic girl on a rainy day running and jumping in the hallways, bouncing a ball, noises echoing, typical working-class Bronx Jewish first-generation kid. Me. I clearly saw and heard myself as a 10-year-old girl again, tossing my beloved Spalding ball. Mickey and I began comparing notes about our families and our oh too small apartments. I was fascinated by his stories, of his Aunt Frances and how she became his renegade role model, of how when he attended the Bronx High School of Science, he first started getting knowledge of lives different from his own. Lives where some kids even had their own bedrooms, and where the family expectation was that the children, without a doubt, would go to college. Standing with Mickey, a picture of confidence and success in our shop-worn surroundings, both of us excited about comparing stories about our past, started me wondering about other interesting and accomplished people from the Bronx. What were their stories? What were their childhoods like? Who influenced them? How did they find a place for themselves in the larger world, the one beyond their own Bronx neighborhoods? The idea for Just Kids from the Bronx was beginning to hatch. I started out cautiously by interviewing only friends. Mickey was among the first kids I talked with. Two longtime pals of mine, the producers Martin Bregman and David Yarnell, were also delighted to be included in my project. Regis Philbin, both a friend and a wonderful storyteller who lives down the hall from me in our Manhattan building, eagerly said, "I'll be happy to talk to you. I had a great childhood in the Bronx." The enthusiasm they all showed for the project, along with the comic adventures described in those initial interviews, launched this book. Friends then recommended friends, and acquaintances mentioned names they had recognized but didn't know personally. "Did you talk to so-and-so?" I knew my growing helter-skelter list of names excluded many who were worthy and interesting, which meant this book was not to be a comprehensive history of all the great people of the Bronx. But happily, this informally gathered group hinted at the actual changing demographic of the borough over the years, which went from being predominantly Jewish, Italian, and Irish in the earlier part of the 20th century to the current majority populations of African Americans and Hispanics, all of them sharing some pride in the borough that helped raise them. When I talked with Joel Arthur Rosenthal, Jar, the only living jewelry designer to have a retrospective of his work at New York's Metropolitan Museum of Art, he said, "I'm glad that you're doing a book about the Bronx. I'm sick and tired of hearing about Brooklyn." I edited the conversational interviews, taking care to preserve each person's own wording. I arranged the material chronologically so the differences and similarities in each person's life, along with the changes in the Bronx itself, would be more apparent. As the volume of candid personal stories grew, I found I was deeply touched and gratified by the trust these wonderful Bronxites had in me, basically a stranger to most of them. I became riveted as the three graffiti artists of Tat's crew told of their exploits in the 1970s and 80s and what it meant to them to have people see their art on the outside of the number 6 train rolling from the Bronx all the way through Manhattan into Brooklyn and then back again to the Bronx. I was transported by Al Pacino's lyric description of the sounds of the world on his roof in the 1940s. And at night, there was a cacophony of voices, especially in the late spring to late summer. You would hear the different accents. We had them all. There were Italians, Jews, Irish, Polish, German. It was like a Eugene O'Neill play. I laughed with total surprise when David Yarnell told me about his risky exploits in the 40s, secretly growing marijuana in Bronx Park. Teenagers did things like that then? And then there was the 8-year-old Ken Davidson in the 50s, playing with his young band of buddies in the rocky, empty lot next to their apartment house, setting fires. Literally playing with fire. Despite his mother's warning, "You could burn your eyes out!" I was moved and informed by Neil deGrasse Tyson's descriptions of his experiences with racism when he was an innocent and unsuspecting preteen. Similarly, I was appalled by the not-so-subtle racism that Joyce Hansen encountered in high school when her college guidance counselor said, college was for smart kids and therefore not for her. And who knew that the Bronx River was home to an important population of giant snapping turtles? For Eric Zeidler, born in 1991 and still living in the Bronx today, exploring the Bronx River was like opening presents when you're not sure what the present will be, whether it's going to be something you really want or nothing. Seeing and finding these giant turtles in the river is a present I'll never forget. Hearing Eric talk about the turtles in the Bronx River reminded me that there is more parkland in the Bronx, 25% of the place, than in any other borough in New York City. I was lucky enough to grow up about 7 blocks away from Bronx Park, where the Bronx River flows, and which is also home to the world-class Bronx Zoo and the New York Botanical Garden. I was naively happy then, and am humbly grateful now, that although I lived in a more or less urban community, I could explore the park, which first sparked my abiding love of flowers. Sometimes out-of-town friends ask, "The Bronx, exactly where is it?" "You know," I say, "the Bronx is up, the battery's down," like in the Compton and Green lyrics. The Bronx is the northernmost of New York City's 5 boroughs. It was incorporated into the city at large in 1898, and it is the only borough on the mainland. The other 4 boroughs are either islands or attached to Long Island. The Bronx got its name from one of its first settlers, a 17th century Scandinavian named Jonas Bronk, whose lineage had been traced to Sweden and Denmark. He arrived in New Netherland in 1639, farmed some 600 acres in what is now the Motthaven section, and his tract was known as Bronx Land. The river ran south of Bronx Land, and with the change in the spelling, the river and eventually the whole borough were named after him. The separate Bronx villages that arose long after Jonas Bronk's life and times evolved into neighborhoods, communities that were like hometowns. And as in other hometowns across the country, the dwellers knew most everyone, and most everyone knew them. Though the people whose stories I listened to for this book came from many different neighborhoods and grew up in different decades, all of them came from places where parents and neighbors, schools and teachers, stores and storekeepers, houses of worship and clergy were important parts of their lives. By the time I finished editing the more than 60 interviews from 92-year-old Carl Reiners to 23-year-old Eric Zeidler's, I was delighted to see an additional narrative emerging. One of changing decades and disparate times linking arms with one another. Children of Jewish, Italian, and Irish immigrants giving way to children of African American, Puerto Rican, and Dominican newcomers, and I felt moved and connected to them all. During World War II, Avery Corman played stickball in the streets, using the simple treasures of a Spalding ball and a broom handle for a bat. Even though I was a girl and girls didn't play stickball then, those were my years of carefree playing in the streets, too. Years later, similar games continued with even poorer kids creating their ball out of recyclables. As hip-hop's grandmaster Millie Mel, born Melvin Glover, told it, "We take a milk container and a soda bottle and wrap the soda bottle in newspaper and stuff the soda bottle inside the milk container and shape it like a football." Yes, I could imagine doing that as well if I had to. For more than 100 years, the Bronx has been associated with the Yankees, the Bronx Bombers. And across the generation, so many Bronx kids, me included, cheered them on, with many of the boys dreaming of playing pro ball. Bobby Bonilla, who spoke of his indescribable love for his supportive father, was able to realize his baseball player dreams. And Michael Kay, fueled by an intense love of the Yankees and by his own resourcefulness, figured out early on how to get involved. I was practical and rational, even as a 9-year-old, he told me. If I'm going to be part of the Yankees, I'm going to be that broadcaster. So I'd interview my friends with a tape recorder. Michael Kay himself hit a metaphorical home run when he grew up to become a sports journalist and Yankees broadcaster. The Bronx storytellers in this book have found their niches in the fields of religion, law, education, entertainment, business, finance, science, medicine, government, politics, sports, acting, music, drawing, photography, architecture, graphic design, journalism, cartooning, writing, and dancing. Both in spirit and in fact, with their contributions to the larger community, they exemplify possibility. I am so grateful for what started out as a lark, just a fun trip back to the Mayflower. It led to one of the richest experiences of my life, the meeting of the people in and the making of Just Kids from the Bronx, Telling It the Way It Was, an Oral History.
Part 1. Fresh Air, A Lucky Break. I knew that I wanted to be someone. I wanted to be revered by the family. Not only by my immediate one, but my extended family as well. They were all so excited when I finished medical school that they had this large party for me. I still have the pictures. Actually, it spawned many other doctors in the family whose fathers said to them, "Forget about being a wallpaper hanger. If Mickey could do it, then you could do it." Michael Mickey Brescia, M.D. A.M. Abe Rosenthal, Pulitzer Prize-winning correspondent and longtime executive editor of the New York Times, 1922 to 2006. For 7 years, I lived with my 5 sisters and our parents, Sarah and Harry, among flowers and trees, dancing fountains, wilderness paths, birds singing in their ecstasy, and such stupendous quantities of a particular treasure as to send my mother into paroxysms of acquisition greed. "Fresh air," she would announce. And then from her lips came the command that rang through every apartment in the Bronx neighborhood every day. "Go grab some fresh air. Out. Fresh air." As other American pioneers and gamblers kept moving west, the Jews of New York kept moving north toward fresh air. For Harry and his pirate queen, the road led from the tenements of the Lower East Side in Manhattan to Decatur Avenue in the Bronx, where young warriors waited in ambush to pounce on the new kids and eventually declare peace. The adult pioneers worked 6 days a week and every hour of overtime they could get. They saved every penny with pleasure, looking down from the peak above the sea to the pass above the fruited plain Moshalu Parkway Station, far north, only a few miles south of the New York suburb's boundary line. Beyond the station, as far as a house painter's eye could see, stretched Van Cortlandt Park. The ride on the subway was usually an hour or more each way. Coming home, fresh air awaited, ready to be consumed in large gulps, a reservoir never dry. And during the day, breathing the paint or the lint, a working man knew that at least at home, the wife and the children were breathing that fresh air all day long. The pioneers stood and gazed at their children and then went to the bank with their deposit books every few months. Paradise was known as the Amalgamated, for the Amalgamated Clothing Workers Union, which built good housing for its members. Members of other unions were eligible to buy apartments too. Papa's credentials were his card in the house painters union and the bank book of his life savings. By the time we moved into our apartment, Sarah and Harry had been on the waiting list for about 2 years. They both knew Harry would make a living as long as he could climb a painter's ladder or crawl out a window to a scaffold. With overtime, here and there, he could come up with the $80 a month to meet the maintenance charges. They never again might have such a chance. A great park across the street, 4 bedrooms, living room, nice big kitchen, and double exposures.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.